also introducing Professor Carr, who is Assistant Professor of Law in India as well. And her article is about the importance of women as an integral part of the social structure in the society, and how the history has shown that Indian women have struggled to be part of the legal system and fought for their equality rights along with men. And let's invite her to talk more about her abstract law on women and analysis of role of Indian women in law. Professor Carr, please. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, Amelia. I'm audible. Very good afternoon to all the participants here. My topic is Law and Women and Analysis of Role of Indian Women in Law. So as far as my topic is concerned, the title itself is very suggestive of that, why we are taking the two terms together, that we are putting up the word law and we are putting up the word women along with it. This shows a struggle the women has gone for the way to achieve the rights of equality along with the men. If I particularly, because here I'm talking about the Indian women, I'm analyzing her role, what the role she has played as far as India is concerned. The women has been in a very deplorable condition. If I talk about the ancient Indian society, the position, the respect the women enjoyed, that was beyond, it was a very commendable place she was having in the society. But with the passage of time, with the invasions, they were India was invaded time and again, the position of the women became very deplorable. That women has to fight, the history is full of the instances where the women has come forth to put and place that she is also an important part of the world. If you see, the world is incomplete without the participation of the women. And I think the legal field is one such where even we cannot ignore the participation of the women. The women has to walk hand in hand along with the men. So my most of the part has been covered by Dr. Ms. Singh only, but still coming to this position that women and law, why this thing is so important. We have been teaching this subject in India for the purpose of making the law students to aware of that what kind of struggle the Indian women has gone through and what struggle till date we are fighting to be a part of the mainstream. As far as the Indian independence is concerned, we are still influenced by the colonial laws, the laws which were imposed by the British only. So as far if we talk about the Indian laws, the position of the women, even you find that there is gender discrimination being done to the women. The struggle of the Indian women has been, if I talk about the Indian women struggling in the legal field, started in the year 1916 when one of the Bengali lady, she just qualified her law degree and she was not allowed to practice anywhere. Her struggle after a decade brought into a change in that we have a Legal Practitioners Act 1923, by which the women were also allowed. The discrimination of sex was omitted from there and women were given equal participation, that they could also come and participate and they can profess the legal profession. So this is the status of the women in law, that we being an equal citizens. So whenever we talk about the struggle of the women, we talk about any kind of the struggle for which we are talking about our rights, the struggle is very important. And that we want to recognize ourselves that we are as important as the men folk of the country is concerned. So as far as the struggle of Indian women is concerned, post-independence, the Constitution of India has given, granted so many rights to the women. The Indian Constitution is very gender neutral, that it is providing equal rights. It is based on the principles of equality. It is based on the principles of fraternity, that we are squaring all the equal rights to the women also. But along with that, still we have been struggling. It's only after 2013 that we can analyze that the women, they have been given their role in the society, that they have been recognized, they are also an important part. So India got independence in the year 1950, and in 1955 we had this the concept of natural guardian. So only the father, the male person in the family, was held to be the natural guardian. And when constitution, we are talking about the equality principle, that all the men and the women, no discrimination is being done on the grounds of sex and all. But in 1955, we had this Guardians of Wardship Act. In this act, the women was not recognized as a natural guardian of her own child. So with struggle, this gender discrimination was removed in one of the cases by the Supreme Court, and the woman is also regarded as a natural guardian of the child in the absence of the father. Then along with this, we have so many discriminatory laws which are still prevailing, but still the lot is not that bad at the international level. We have this CEDA, which is providing that any kind of discrimination is not to be done with the women. So as far as the Indian women is concerned, in the Western, if we see the struggle of the women, the struggle mainly revolved around getting the civil rights only. But as far as India is concerned, Indian the women, the struggle was not that much. The only the leaders of the nation, when we were fighting for the war of independence, the leaders, the people who were educated from the Western side, like Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Mahatma Gandhi, they encouraged the women that they also have to be a part of the national mainstream, and they want to be and they should come forward and be a part of the national mainstream. So after independence, even after 2013, we can say that we have lots of law which are working for ameliorating the lot of the women. We have a sexual prevention of sexual harassment of women at the workplace, that the women will not be sexually harassed. So this law we have, then we have this protection of women from domestic violence act. And then we have this Equal Remuneration Act, that if women are working, they are also provided equal rights along with the men. Then we have this Maternity Benefit Act, that even if women is working, we are giving her the maternity leave along with the full wages. And 2017, we have brought a change and we have given extensive leave to the woman who is on the motherhood. So you see, the as far as our Indian culture is concerned, the place of the women where she is placed. So when we talk about the working women, and we have to analyze and we have to give a respectable place to the women in India, we have to see, we have to analyze it from the work culture in which we are born. So as far as Indian culture is concerned, we are very much attached to our roots, that the women are not allowed to come out of the house. They only have to be a part in their house, and they have to work within the four corners of the house only. So this thing is that for this kind of, even if in this post COVID-19 situation, if we talk about that, we are not techno savvy as far as Indian women is concerned, or the institutions where we are working. Again, because we are living in a male dominated society, this is what the Indian society is all about. And for this reason, the women had struggled a lot to be at par with the women, so that they can walk hand in hand with the men. So even if we talk about the role of women in law, they have to fight for their rights. Then only they were secured their rights that they could become. So the main reason here is that we have to make that there are gender problems in our law itself only. If the law is gender neutral, we can see that there is no need that the wife woman need to come and she has to fight for her rights. The history is full of the instances where the woman has been fighting for her rights, that she is as equal, as important part of the society, that she also has to participate in the national mainstream. So this is the reason that why we are teaching, or if we talk about the feminist jurisprudence, which is a available in India. The family jurisprudence, first of all, was more concerned with that we need to bring in the law reforms. Law reforms are not important. Already we have so many laws which have been reformed, many of the evil practices like the sati practice, where the woman was burned at the pyre of the dead husband. We have done away with this. Dowry, to some extent, we are again dealing with this problem of dowry, but it is moving away. So the move of the feminism has now turned from that, instead of having reforms in the society, we are talking about empowerment of the women. Now again, the next question is why we are talking about the empowerment of the women. I think in this present century, most of the women, we are empowered women only. We are sitting here, we are taking the help of the technology, we are disseminating our views, we are sharing our opinions. The point is that we need to make the women more independent. We have to give her more freedom. On black and white, we have everything in India. As far as the Constitution of India is concerned, being a teacher of constitutional law, my more focus would be on constitution only. Then starting with, we have a full-fledged chapter on the fundamental rights, where we are talking in one of the articles about the protective discrimination, that we can make special provision for uplifting the status of the woman, even if we are discriminating with the men. When we have all the things are there on black and white, it's available. But where is the problem? The problem is that the Indian women, the setup, the Indian kind of setup we are having, the Indian culture we are following, in that place, the women are not allowed to come out. The women are not independent. I was reading one of the feminist chapters on that the men are able to work because they have the women are doing an unpaid service at home. When men are only concerned with working outside, women are only concerned with working inside the four corners of the house. And this mindset, I think, needs to be changed. Everything is available, technology is available. The only thing is that we have to make the women access to these technologies. If I talk about our own law school where I'm teaching, we have more number of girl students rather than the boy students who are learning laws. So in this situation, the woman has already become empowered. The point is to show her the true path, that where she has to go, what she has to learn, and what she has to offer to the society in the long run. So as far as law and women, they are very much connected with each other. We cannot think of a law where women are not present, because on the one side, we're talking about a rule of law society, which is based on the principle of equality. So we cannot ignore these things also. So as far as the legislations in India is concerned, now we have a very one interesting legislation that we are making a bill, which is being pending in the Rajya Sabha for a long time, for giving 33% representation to the women in the government. Now this bill could not see the light of the day. Reason being, because the male chauvinism doesn't want to see the women, that they should come and stand with them. Then we have certain amendments made in the constitution that in the democracy, at least at the grassroots level, we are giving 1/3 reservation to the women, that she can come and she can participate at the grassroots level. So the point here, my point here, simple is this, that we have been struggling and the struggle is still on, but where to draw the line? We have all the laws. The point here is that we need to disseminate maximum knowledge. We need to connect to the grassroots women, the women who are illiterate, the women who are uneducated. In India, we are following this thing that beti padhao, beti bachao. It means teach the daughter and you can save the daughter. It means that we need to make our women very financially independent also, so that they can recognize. We can see that these days, lots of women, first it was a tag only that the practice in the low courts is not meant for the girls. But these days, this taboo has also been removed. We can equally see that there are women, they are teaching in the law school, there are women who are practicing in the higher courts of the land, there are women who are excelling in each and every field. So here we say that why we have to write this, again, the struggle, that why this word women and law we are using. We never use the word law and men, because men has already, we are still following the colonial, that in India again, the British has already left this practice that we recognize the identity of the woman on the basis of the husband. The caste of the woman is whatever the caste of the husband is. I think the need of the hour is that we have to remove all these barriers. All these long archaic laws have to be removed so that the women can be put in place and the position the women deserve in the society. She has to be brought and she has to be given that platform. Indian history is full of the instances where the struggle of the women, you can see, even during independence, we have seen that the women have struggled to fight for their own rights only. And the women have participated so, and they have proved their mettle. They are equally fighting for the independence of the country. But post-independence, still if we say that we have such draconian laws which are discriminating with the women. But after 2013, we have brought amendments in our criminal law. So we have amended our criminal law that any kind of, we have included our criminal law incidents like acid attack, then voyeurism, stalking, all these offenses, they have been made as offenses only. Then I was talking about domestic protection of women from the domestic violence, that any kind of violence which is being committed with the women, that can be. But the need is that we are having the laws, we are having everything. The point is that we need to disseminate this knowledge to those group of women who are not enlightened, who are not educated, and how we can do this thing. Because now these days we can use the technology. In a way, when we are teaching in our law schools, we are teaching the subject law and women and law. So we are somewhere disseminating this information that these are the laws which are available for the women. So we need to make our daughters that they should study so that they can become a part of the national mainstream. For this weekend, the thing we have National Commission for Women, which is working in India for improving the lot of the women. But again, the National Commission is going to work on those things only which are being reported. Some crimes in India, they are not being even reported. Even because we are brought up in such Indian culture that women are not allowed to move out, that women are meant to be a part of the family. Even if they are being beaten up, even if they are being given any kind of ill treatment, they are not bound to go out of the family way. So all this mindset needs to be changed. Then only we can recognize the role the Indian women has played. And still we have to see the examples which have been set in the history, that how we have fought for securing this place in India, that we are being treated as a person. In our jurisprudence, there is a word reasonable person. We never recognize that reasonable person includes a woman also. So we have lots of case laws which are dealing with this thing, that reasonable person doesn't mean that only a man is entitled to do this work. The person includes both the men and the women only. So such discriminatory laws, such discrimination which we are doing, that gender problems which in our law that need to be thought of, and we can have lots of feminism literature is available here. We are talking about that, no, this gender discrimination has to be removed, that we have to make our laws very gender neutral. Although our laws are very gender neutral, we have this prevention of women from the sexual harassment at the workplace. All these laws, they are being made for emancipating the women from the old archaic laws which were prevailing in the country. But again, my humble submission here would be this, when concluding my this abstract would be that the problem is not with the law, the problem is the women, that they have to come to the forefront. They have to still struggle for getting their respectable position in the society, that this is what they deserve and this is not what they are being given and what kind of treatment they are being meted as far as the Indian culture is concerned. Thank you very much. If any questions, they are most welcome.